Israeli forces leave the Al-Shifa hospital in Gaza City after a two-week operation. Israel says it killed or detained hundreds of Hamas militants and seized weaponry and intelligence documents. It adds it lost two soldiers in the fighting but sought to prevent harm to civilians, patients, and staff. Thousands of Palestinians had sought shelter in Gaza's largest hospital complex, one of the few locations in the north with some access to electricity and water. An Israeli government spokesperson praising the operation.
I believe that the terrorist takeover of Shifa and the subsequent special forces operation to clear the hospital of terrorists will be studied by future generations of military strategists at West Point and Sandhurst as the gold standard for urban warfare. The Prime Minister confirmed, and I quote, "Our forces operated there in an exemplary fashion. Shifa has become a main terrorism command center for Hamas. The surprise action by our forces was precise and surgical."
Palestinian officials, meanwhile, called the raid on Al-Shifa a war crime. Hamas and medics have denied any armed presence in Gaza's hospitals. Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu vows to shutter the local office of Qatari news station Al Jazeera as the war in Gaza continues. This comes after the Israeli parliament approved a bill allowing the temporary closure of foreign broadcasters considered to be a threat to national security. Al Jazeera, which has been fiercely critical of the military operation in Gaza, calls accusations it has harmed Israel's security a dangerous and ridiculous lie. The White House, meanwhile, expresses concerns over the station's possible shutdown.
If it is true, a move like this is concerning. We believe in the freedom of the press. It is critical. It is critically important, and the United States supports the critically important work journalists around the world do. And so, and that includes those who are reporting in the conflict in Gaza.
Israel accused of a deadly attack on Iran's consulate in the Syrian capital, Damascus. Syrian state media says at least six people were killed and several more were injured in the airstrike. Iranian state media, meanwhile, identified one of the fatalities as Mohammad Reza Zahidi, a senior commander in Iran's Revolutionary Guard. He is believed to have been the target of the attack. Iran's ambassador to Syria vowing to respond to the deadly airstrike. Israel, which has repeatedly hit Iranian targets during the six-month war in Gaza, has declined to comment on the reports. In Tehran, Iranian protesters burned Israeli and American flags as they gathered to condemn the attack. The U.S. Coast Guard establishing a temporary alternate channel for government and commercial vessels involved in response efforts to the collapse of the Francis Scott Key Bridge in Baltimore, Maryland. This marks the first step in reopening the Port of Baltimore, one of the busiest on the eastern seaboard. It has been closed since Tuesday last week, leaving in limbo the jobs of some 15,000 people. U.S. President Joe Biden will be traveling to Baltimore Friday to meet with local officials as he surveys the damage.
The president is continuing to lead a whole-of-government approach to the collapse. President Biden and his team are working with Governor Moore, the congressional delegation, Mayor Scott, and numerous state and local officials to reopen the port, rebuild the bridge, and support the people of Baltimore.
The Biden administration has released $60 million in initial emergency aid. Federal officials estimate the final cost of rebuilding the bridge could reach $2 billion. Let's find out what stories our North America Bureau is pursuing right now from our Bureau Chief, TJ Manotok.
Good morning to our friends at The Rundown. Here are the top stories in the North American region. There's only 2 weeks left until taxes are due, and here's what Filipino Americans need to know to file their taxes before the deadline.
For most taxpayers in the U.S., a deadline to file their federal tax return, pay any tax owed, or request an extension to file is Monday, April 15th. But you can ask for more time by filing an automatic six-month extension by April 15th without citing an explanation to the IRS. This extension only gives you more time to file your federal income tax return, but you must still pay all your taxes owed for 2023 by the April 15th deadline. Otherwise, you could face fines and penalties in addition to the taxes you owe. There are payment plans available to people who do not have the money to pay their tax bills by April 15. However, under those plans, penalties will still be charged. Tax advisors say you should not skip filing if you cannot pay the taxes you owe, because if you skip filing, you'll have to pay a penalty for failing to file in addition to failing to pay the tax owed.
On to the news on the NCAA March Madness. Filipina Caleb Padilla brings the University of Southern California to its first Elite Eight since 1994.
Caleb Padilla has helped the USC Trojans advance to the Elite Eight of the NCAA Women's Tournament. After a 74-70 win over Baylor on Saturday, USC has reached this level in the competition for the first time in 30 years. The fifth-year senior scored 8 points with 4 rebounds and 3 assists. USC will face Connecticut on Monday night with a chance to advance to the Final Four. Padilla, a Southern California native, transferred to USC this season after spending 4 years at the University of Pennsylvania, where she was among the top Ivy League scorers. The sharp shooting guard has been averaging 10 points per game in the first 4 rounds of the NCAA Women's Tournament.
And finally, in entertainment news, we get to know Caloocan-born rapper Zay, who's talking about making Filipino empowerment songs that are now on Hollywood TV shows.
Zay Zacarias, Zay to her fans, is passionate about Filipina female empowerment, and it shows in her art. Her songs, which she independently releases on online platforms, have caught the attention of Hollywood music supervisors. The 23-year-old rapper from Caloocan talks about her song that made it to Theo James' Netflix hit series, The Gentleman.
We received an email, and I was like, The Gentleman? For real? I was just waiting for the confirmation, because it's a big deal. It's a huge opportunity for Filipino music, diba? Para ma-feature sa isang international show. I'm a dog.
Zay writes and performs to express her perspective as a young Filipina who owns her power, generational trauma, gender inequality, and patriarchal barriers notwithstanding.
There had to be someone who says something about it, and I just wanted to do it.
Zay is currently working on her EP to be released this year.
And those are the news making the headlines in the North American region. You can catch more of our TFC News on our website, news.abs-cbn.com/TFC News. Head on over to the ABS-CBN News YouTube channel and download the ABS-CBN News app for your smartphones and tablets. I'm TJ Manotok. Back to our friends at The Rundown.